Hello and welcome to Create, a new arts programme for the UK.
We're going to look at all things creative from around the country.
Yeah, that's because we think we know our arts from our elbow. Anyway, my name's Andrew Kay.
And I'm Yael Breuer.
And let's get started. I don't believe that stars are born, and I don't even believe that stars can be made. I think they fall from heaven, and one such star is Miss Hope Springs. Hello, Hope.
Hello.
It's lovely to have you here.
Hi.
And you're busy again. We're out of lockdown. You've got lots of gigs coming up.
Oh, my goodness. Yes, lots and lots of shows all over the world.
Fabulous.
Non-stop.
Tell me, I mean, it's been a tough time for performers. We've had 18 months where you couldn't really go out and do things. And for some performers, they didn't really like doing things virtually. Did you do anything virtual?
No, I didn't. I think my audience demands a certain standard and production qualities that come with what I do. And I just couldn't bring that to the screen from my camper van in Dungeness. It was just too tight a squeeze. And I've also got my husband Irving in there and his close personal friend Carlos, the hairdresser, and we all squeezed in there. So it was a little tight to put on a show, especially when you consider the dancing elephants.
Tell me a little bit about your private life. So I know you live with your husband and his close friend.
Well, we live in a camper van in Dungeness, which is the beautiful Kentish Riviera. I don't know if you know it, warmed by the currents from the nuclear power station. And when Irving told me he was getting a little camper, I was like, I don't think that's possible. And you know, it's been a little bit of a tricky ride the last, I don't know, how many years is it? Feels like 70.
But in a camper van.
Yes.
With Irving and Carlos.
Carlos.
I mean, is there any room for you to have a personal life? Or even, dare I say it, an intimate life?
Well, I don't think I've ever had an intimate life, especially not with Irving. I mean, it was one, I did have a funny dream about a pair of knickers and a sausage once, and that was it. we do have, oh, and I can't tell you that story. There'll probably be children watching. So I don't know what to say. It's a little bit of a personal question, Andrew. I didn't come here and ask you about your sex life, did I?
Well, I don't have one.
I'd like to know how old you are. I'm not asking you how old you are, but I know that you've been performing since the 60s. So that means that you were already probably a grown-up then.
Yes.
We might have been a child star.
Or maybe.
I was actually a fetus star.
Were you?
Yes, I came out in a sequin pantsuit and started. Actually, almost my mother, Rusty Springs, she just shot me out, and I went straight on stage.
Right, so and I've been it's going a real natural,
since.
Right.
Yeah, I'm only 39.
Are you happy? You know, when I listen to your music, I am literally split in the middle between being amused and being melancholic. What about you?
I'm on drugs, so but both. I would say, I think possibly, you know, if I take a little bit of one, it's one thing. If I take a little bit too much of something else, it's the other. And then it all comes out in this wonderful cocktail.
And it is a wonderful cocktail. I have to say, listening to you is absolutely mesmerizing.
Well, that's so kind of you. Thank you.
But are these songs drawn from personal experience? Or
absolutely.
Do you have a fabulous power of invention?
I do have a power of invention, but it's definitely autobiographical, I would say. And you know, I think a little bit of past life regression in some instances, you know. Evidently there's recently found a mural of me playing a lyre in a brothel in Pompeii.
And any inspiration from the outside world, apart from your own experience?
I think I'm inspired by the greats of Hollywood. Marlene Dietrich, mm-hmm. Judy Garland, mm-hmm. Joan Crawford, Betty Davis, Garbo, the lot.
You know? Your career has had some real highs, though, and some dips.
The dips is very guacamole.
But I mean, it's only 2 years since you were in Edinburgh, and Miss Hope Springs actually won a seriously prestigious award.
Is it 2 years?
It's 2 years.
2019.
It is, yeah.
Yes, yes. Well, just tell them what I won, darling.
Well, I think you won the Best of the Fringe Award.
Best of everything.
Best of everything.
I won Best Cabaret. Edinburgh Fringe Broadway World Awards, which was very nice.
And I saw the show, and it was worthy of that award. It was beautiful.
Right. And it has been described as a Rolls Royce of shows.
Well, that's a very nice way of putting it. I don't know, from some angles, I'm about the size of a Rolls Royce.
And need frequently oiling.
And my big end's gone, which is something else.
You famously recorded a fabulous hour-long special for Granada back in the 60s. What happened to it? Do the tapes exist?
Darling, that was my 1971 Granada TV special, Christmas A Go-Go, which I bring back every year. I sort of recreate it live on the West End stage at the Crazy Cots, live at Sedell, and around the country. That's my Christmas show. But I just recorded an hour for the fabulous Wigmore Hall, which is free to stream. It's on their website. I was invited back to Wigmore Hall, which is like a very, very prestigious classical venue.
It is a prestigious and you're worthy of it. You're a brilliant talent, a beautiful woman, one of the funniest people I've ever met and known.
Darling,
and we wish you all luck.
What are you doing after the interview?
Well, we could go for a drink, I'm sure. You'll have to go.
I'll have to go. I know, I'm not going to come too,
honey.
Listen, best of luck. I know you're going to be travelling around the UK a lot. You're going to be performing in London and in Brighton.
Yes.
And a
UK tour is on the cards.
Even better. Everyone can catch you there. That's Miss Hope Springs. She'll be with you very soon, bringing her own inimitable cabaret. Thank you.
Smokes hashish smuggled in from Senegal in a seedy little nightclub in Pigalle. There's a lady from Marseille who plays the saw, and for tips she'll do it backwards in the raw. What that lady used to do for an encore was obscene. Furthermore, now she keeps a wooden leg behind the door. A drawing on a napkin by Chagall in a seedy little nightclub in Pigalle. Middle eight, be discreet if you will. There's an entrance off the street. Let's be naughty. Don't forget to pay your bill. Don't forget to wipe your feet, for the carpet's not been cleaned since 1940. It's like a scene out of a book by Jean Genet. Sunday night, the cabaret is gay. The most beautiful of boys come out to play, mime to songs and satay. And the older gentleman will always pay. It's a bigger marketplace than Old Leal in a seedy little nightclub in Pigalle. Instrumental. Prostitute called Maud, and her pimp, a lofty lesbian called Claude. They offered me menage a trois. I said, oh Lord, perhaps I might some night if I was bored. Well, it certainly helped to boost a girl's morale in a seedy little nightclub in Big Al. God, my agent, Sid, would have a petty mal. That's a kind of fit. He would scold me, yes indeedy, if he saw me being needy in a seedy little nightclub in Big Al. But I'd say, Sid, Sid, I probably said three times, knowing me, Sid, if it was good enough for Piaf, then it's good enough for Miaf. Yeah, it's probably not my best work. If I want to, and I want to, then I shall. Come for cocaine or the quarrel, come for anything immoral. The press rave that the most depraved locale is a seedy little nightclub in Big Al.
Comment about Brighton is it's not always such a clean city, but Clean the Musical is about Brighton. It's about a specific neighborhood in Brighton, and Sam Chittenden is here to talk about the musical.
Hello.
So tell us about Clean. What is Clean about?
So it's the story of seven different women who live in the Round Hill area of Brighton, which is an area where a lot of the laundries and bakeries and other services for Brighton used to be in Georgian times and Victorian times. And it tells the stories of those seven women from 1880 through to 2021. And we kind of see how the things that they're facing, the challenges, are very similar, even though they're from different periods, they're very similar issues.
Are these characters real characters that you've researched, or have you manipulated?
I've kind of been creative with. So one of the characters, Dr. Helen Boyle, is a real character, and she started the first mental health hospital for women back in 1905. She was one of the first female GPs in the country. She's a real trailblazer.
And the building is still there.
She was my GP, actually.
Well, the building that was her hospital is there in Round Hill Crescent, and it's going to get a blue plaque later this year to sort of recognise her contribution. But she then set up the Lady Chichester Hospital, which became Aldrington House in Church Road in Hove.
Right.
So she's the one real character. The others are fictionalised characters, but using real history.
But based on research.
Yes, so based on research about the laundries, about particularly the smallpox outbreak. So in 1950 to 51, there was a smallpox outbreak in Brighton.
And that's an interesting sort of parallel with what we've been going through.
Absolutely. So all the stuff about quarantine, about manual track and trace. So, because one of the laundries was implicated in the smallpox spreading because of the bedding that came from one person's house. So they had to track everybody who'd had laundry, about 1,000 people with no computers to do it. They had to track everyone who'd been in a taxi because it was a taxi driver who was the first fatality. So everybody who'd been in his taxi had to be found. So, and queues for vaccines. So yes, very, very interesting echoes, obviously, of where we are today.
Now, you made this piece of theatre a couple of years ago as a straightforward play.
Yes.
Why have you turned it into a musical?
Well,
or a play with music?
Yes. So it was a one-act play, a kind of a typical fringe-length play that we put on in 2019. We staged it in a garden in Round Hill, so a garden that used to be a laundry drying field. And because it was outside, we decided that rather than have recorded music, we wanted to use live music for audience coming in and out, just to create a bit of atmosphere. And that went down so well that we decided that we would extend that part of it. My husband wrote the music and I wrote the lyrics. So, yes, we spent summer 2019, writing another 12 songs.
I'm particularly interested in the musical because I live in Roundhill.
Yes.
And so did you.
I did.
So is that what drew you to the subject to start with?
Yes, I think because it's such a, you know, such a historic area. There are all sorts of, you know, all sorts of fascinating stories. I was very lucky. There are lots of lovely books about the area, and the Roundhill Society have collated a lot of that information. So there was lots to go on, and the more I researched, the more I sort of went down a kind of rabbit hole into all of these fascinating stories. So I suppose it's a bit like a love letter to Roundhill.
It is. I mean, I love Roundhill Crescent. It's a very beautiful road in the city. And does it have the same sense of a community these
days? I think it does. I don't know about the same sense of community because, you know, things have obviously changed. But yes, people often comment on the fact that there's a strong sense of...
Because you talk about the Roundhill Society and,
yes,
you know, it's wonderful the way people get together and saving history is becoming such a strong thread in modern life.
Yeah.
It must make things easier.
Could be quite
a theatre maker.
Well, I think, you know, saving it and acknowledging it, but you also using that, so the history is really powerful, but it's also about what does it tell us about today, about who we are
about ourselves
now.
Yeah.
And, you know, one of the themes that runs through it is how important for women, working women going back to, you know, to the 1800s, how important the support they got from each other would have been. You know, before there was any support available from the state, before Helen Boyle started up her hospital, all they had was each other.
Importantly, when you've created a piece of theatre like this, is how will it travel? Will it travel well around the UK? Because I'm sure you're going to tour this.
Yes.
And, you know, will it have the same relevance? The Roundhill thing you say in Brighton is, of course, important.
Yeah.
But outside Brighton, it's going to be more about the women's experience.
It's more about the stories, yeah. Absolutely. So yes, there's a local draw, isn't there? Because we're doing it in Brighton. Hopefully people will want to know about their city. But I think more importantly are the generic stories. It's a very feminist piece. It explores the challenges that these women have faced, but ultimately it's a sort of celebration of their resilience and their support for each other. And I think that talks to people everywhere.
You talked a little bit about it being a typical fringe length thing, the first thing that you mm-hmm. created. But a typical fringe thing is not to have six people and a musician on stage because it's quite an expensive job,
yes.
Especially if you have to tour.
Yes.
And taking them on the road. I mean, is that a concern?
It's certainly an issue. It's a consideration, and it does mean that you have to be looking at venues that are large enough to have an audience that will...
Bums on seats paying for you to be there.
Yeah. We're lucky we're in a large venue in Brighton, so we can get more people than we would if we were, again, in a typical fringe venue.
Yeah.
But
I certainly won't feel the same from now on when I put some clothes in the washing machine in Roundhill Crescent.
Well, I'm just waiting for the revised version in 2 years' time when we have a new version and you're one of the characters in it. Because I can see that happening.
Can you?
Yeah, absolutely. Sure, you can as well,
keep,
aren't you?
It can keep renewing itself.
Because history, I always say to people, history starts today.
Yes.
And if you're writing something that is historical, then tomorrow, what we did today
Absolutely. Becomes
part of it.
Well, and it's been... I've rewritten parts of it since it was on in 2019. So the character who acts as the narrator, in effect, who comes back to Roundhill having been away for a long time, has been affected by COVID. So, and she's making a, you know, noticing the parallels between COVID and the smallpox story she's talking about.
Well, we've got a clip that we can actually show. I have to say, having seen it, how on earth do you find so many fabulous people with such beautiful voices? I mean, I take it your husband has been the musical director.
That's right. He's the musical director. He's written the songs and arranged all of the songs. We've worked together on soundscapes in the past for theatre, but this is the first real joint project we've done together, which has been exciting. Yeah.
And this is going now. What's in the pipeline for the future?
So we're going to Eastbourne and Litlington, which is the village where I'm based, in September. And then we're hoping that on the back of this production, we'll be able to tour later in the year.
And another project?
We spent lockdown writing a second musical. So we've written an adaptation of The Little Prince.
How lovely.
So looking to get that out probably next year.
Beautiful. Well, let's take a look at this now and... good luck with the tour.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming in.
A pleasure.
sister, my friend. My mother, my daughter, my sister, my friend.
I don't worship God kneeling nor sat on some pew. But in this tented church made of linen and tea,
season
Song Something to Believe In was written by our next guest, Sarah Fisher and Esta Ray. Welcome to Create.
Thank you.
What a beautiful song. But it's actually quite a recent thing for you. You started writing together in the last couple of years, is
yes,
that right?
That's correct. Mm-hmm.
So your careers were very different before that. I know, Esta, you were more jazz and you were more pop.
I was, and I am.
She still is.
Yeah. Yes, I still am. Yeah.
And how did you meet? I mean, were you thrown together?
We were thrown together, yeah. We met through a friend of Sarah's. I was actually looking for someone to co-write with, and a pianist and someone who, you know, sort of music. And she suggested Sarah and said Sarah can play anything and everything. So I thought, oh, that sounds great.
So it was a creative blind date.
It was, yeah.
did you actually like each other when you met?
Oh, well.
I met Esther, you can be honest. I met Esther in some sleazy West End bar.
That I belong to.
Yes.
This is the Phoenix Club, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's not that sweet, and I
saw her and I thought, oh my God.
With my big leopard print top on. Looking like a drag queen, actually, didn't I?
I said, I can't believe it.
Yeah. You just sound very harmonious together. That works really well. What's the process like of co-writing? I always think that people who are, you know, creative and in different ways, and obviously you come from two different kind of styles, and how did it work?
Okay, so I mean, Esther, at the beginning, you know, you just said, well, I've got some lyrics, let's try and put some music to it. Yeah. And that's actually, it was our first song that we wrote together, was Something to Believe In.
Yeah.
And, you know, but basically what happens is sometimes Esther will come up with a tune, melody, and a few lyrics, and then from there, I take it further.
To the next level.
I said, I need some more lyrics, And then, away we go. And then,
It's lovely to have you here. Lovely to hear you. We're going to have you a little bit more from you now.
Okay.
And you can actually find them, Fisher and Ray, on Facebook fan page.
And also, we have done Love Forever Burns, which is the next song, is out on all the media platforms.
Yeah, you can get
platforms.
Download it on iTunes.
Yes, iTunes.
Let's have a listen. You can go and get ready. We'll have a
look. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Lovely talking to you.
Sweetness of our kiss, feel your warm skin near me. All my fears just melt away. I know that you can hear me. In the distance, there is a light that's looking so inviting. I long to travel there to you. I long to travel there. The years go by
It's not every day that we have a Queen's Gold Medalist here at the latest TV studios, but we do have today John Agard, who is a poet, a playwright, an all-round fantastic writer and a performer. John, welcome to the studio.
Thanks for inviting me.
Welcome, John. I'm actually glued to this book, and I know it's written for children, but actually I want it. It's just beautiful. I mean, the words are beautiful, but the illustrations are absolutely stunning. I mean, take a look at this. This is Piet Grobler.
Piet Grobler, yeah.
And I was doing the Dutch pronunciation.
Yeah,
there.
Beautiful illustrations. I call him Piet, and we only met about a week or two ago on Zoom. We never actually met in person. So I kept calling him Piet, and I think it's Pete.
It is Pete, yes.
Piet Grobler.
I know. I've called Piet Mondrian for years, but it's Piet Mondrian. It's quite familiar, isn't it, Pete?
Yeah, exactly.
These are beautiful. I mean, in children's books, the illustrations are so important, but it leads them into reading, doesn't it? It makes a child conscious of the words when they see the image at the same time. How much do you have to focus on that when you're writing?
Well, some extended stories, you know, might be a great story, but not necessarily a picture book and material. So I suppose when you're actually writing, you are not the artist, but like you can almost visualize. And it happens without thinking too much, cinematically. And you realize, for example, you can be too extensive in description. So some marvelous picture books can be very, like one line, you took off your socks and then you see feet on the beach. You leapt into the water, you see feet in the water, without describing in detail. So Pete Grobler did a wonderful job. And the other book, my Japanese artist,
great
Momoko
title, Books Make
Abe.
Good Pets.
Well,
they do. You
when
do
I read that,
after them.
When I read that in front of a class, say, because it has that chorus, books make good pets and don't need going to the vet. I'm hoping it will turn on children to the beauty of reading or visiting a library. And but at the same time, you can't, as a writer, preach. The challenge is how do you make it exciting, delightful, all these old-fashioned words, yeah.
But somehow, your poetry is being taught at GCSE. It's on the GCSE syllabus in this country, and I know for my own daughter that pupils absolutely love your poetry. But I always feel sorry for those who only read your poetry and not have the opportunity to listen to you reading the poetry, because you're talking about the visual aspect of poetry, and you yourself bring the poems to life just by the way you read them, by your rhythm. In a way, that's a shame, but, you know, that's the way it is, I suppose.
Well, I wouldn't necessarily say it's a shame, because when we were growing up in the Caribbean, in what would have been a colonial society, British Guyana, our curriculum was very much British-based. And our teachers in the Caribbean are very proactive and very encouraging. And if you imagine a 16-year-old Caribbean child or young adolescent, they encourage us to go to what was then the British Council. And you might borrow these old vinyl. It might be, if you're studying The Tempest, which we had to do in sixth form, you might borrow it and listen to Richard Burton or John Gielgud or, you know. And you get a feel, or you borrow On the Milkwood, and you hear Dylan Thomas. Mm-hmm. So if the language on the page excites you, it's a bonus if you can see the poet and experience the poet. But even if you can't, because as a young guy, like maybe in my late teens, I was turned on by the Mersey Song, the Liverpool poets, Roger McGough, Brian Patton, Adrian Henry. I just saw the book in a bookshop.
And they were very much at the British forefront of poetry becoming a performance.
Spoken word rather than just poetry.
You're going back to the 60s, but I never dreamt that one day I'll stand on the same stage with them. Because, you know, when you see a book and you hold it, you tend to think the writer maybe lived in ancient times or a long time back, and you never imagine that. But that whole period, there was an electrical charge.
There was a warmth as well, and I think that's really important. I'd like to go to spoken word events, and I'd like to hear the work of a writer in their own voice, because that is going to be the most authentic. You talk about Dylan Thomas reading Under Milk Wood. It is the most authentic version that you will ever get.
Yeah, there's something warm and touching. Regardless of how, if there was a poet in his 90s or her 90s, and, you know, and the words are coming out slowly, you just feel blessed that you've heard this poet utter the words they took ages maybe to write. But the one thing I would be careful about is because, unfortunately, there has been a kind of dichotomy or a polarity, and people speak of performance poetry. Well, I wouldn't say I'm writing performance poetry. I think that's a dangerous dichotomy at times, because the Liverpool poets, for example, in regard to the so-called canon, they were might not be seen as literary. And this was often applied to Caribbean poets as well. But if you look back to poets who might be considered literary and part of the canon, you can go right back to Dante. Sung at a banquet. You can go right back to Auden. Apparently he recited by memory long poems. But as the Western world got more and more page-oriented, memorization was lost.
We're very lucky because we have the luxury of having you here in the studio today. And I know that you've brought a new piece along.
An unpublished piece.
This is an exclusive.
Exclusive.
No, well, this has come. I've never read this poem before. It's coming out in a book next year by a publisher, Hatchett's. And her sort of primary, upper primary. It's called Follow That Word.
Well, let's hear that
because
poem
because it explores.
Now.
And I think during these challenging times, I think a lot of people got very prayerful. You know, I certainly reflected on mortality. How could you not?
Yeah.
At a time like this. So maybe subconsciously that was in my mind. And I'm trying to imagine the human race uttering their very first prayer. And these times, you don't have to be religious, shifts the mind, the sort of prayerful state. So this is called the first prayer. What was the first prayer humankind ever said? Was it an appeal to ice to show mercy to nomad feet in need of rest? Was it a heartfelt plea to sun to hold back its fire that the harvest, like their budding dreams, may not wither in the arms of drought? What was the first prayer humankind ever said? Maybe a thank you for the hoped for blessing of rain. Come, bathe, dry ground. Was it out of a deep dung need for the unborn, a chat with the long gone dead. Yes. What was the first prayer humankind ever said? Maybe that very first prayer wasn't even uttered in the shape of a word.
Absolutely wonderful.
It's magical. Thank you so much, John. Thank you for coming in. I don't think you can actually top that by talking about anything else. It's been really wonderful having you here, and I think that's been a real treat for our viewers. Well, thanks for watching Create. Our first episode has gone really smoothly. We've had some terrific guests.
Absolutely. I can't wait for the next one.
But for now, it's good night.
Good night.